Thank you so much for joining. Jonathan,
greetings.
How are you?
Pretty good, pretty good.
So would you let me introduce yourself and then we're really excited around the next 20 minutes speaking to you. So thank you so much for your time. So team, as you know, over the last 9 months, we have been very privileged to have some really great customers to come and spend some time with us. And I think just like we're trying to raise the bar internally, we're now raising the bar with our customers as well. So I think this is a PB for a customer that's spent some time with us. So Audrey, thank you so much. We obviously want to learn around your challenges within the Taiwan government. Would love to know why and your experiences so far with Cloudflare. And also we'd love to understand some of the trends and that you're seeing and you're leveraging both within the Taiwan market, the Greater China market, the Asia Pacific, Japan and market, and then obviously more globally. So just to sort of introduce you properly, our guest, Audrey, has held various leadership positions across the public, private, and social sectors. Audrey is currently Taiwan's Digital Minister for Social Innovation and has been instrumental in Taiwan's digital and technological transformation, has been an advocate for Cloudflare across multiple government agencies in Taiwan. And again, it's my great pleasure to introduce Mr. Audrey Tang. So thank you for the time today. So with that, why don't you tell us about your professional journey? As I said, you've touched private, public, and social sectors. We'd love to understand how you got started and how you got to your current role today, please.
Sure, we literally invited ourselves in when we occupied the parliament in 2014, and that's the Sunflower Movement. The students at the time, 500,000 people on the street and many more online, occupied the parliament to deliberate, not to protest, to deliberate how the trade deal and how, for example, including the PRC components in our then new 4G infrastructure would be a good idea or not, a conversation that everybody else is having now. So my role in that movement is making sure that the clarifications and what's really going on spreads faster than rumor. And that was actually the year the live streaming really took off, right? So we set up multiple live streaming relaying hubs, stenographers, making sure that everything gets translated into multiple languages, real-time captions, a assisted intelligence that helps people to type in their company name or company serial number and find out exactly how the trade deal will affect them and things like that. So broadly speaking, civic tech. And we discovered that with these assistive tools, instead of many other Occupy, which goes nowhere, in Taiwan's case, in 3 weeks, it goes to a good enough consensus, which then was ratified by the parliament. So it was a successful Occupy. So end of 2014, all the mayor candidate that supported open government gets elected, sometimes surprisingly. And the people who didn't, well, didn't. So I was invited to the cabinet as kind of a reverse mentor to the cabinet at a time. After 2 years of kind of internship, I guess, promoted to full time.
Awesome. Cool story. Thank you, Audrey. And amazing sort of things you've been able to achieve in such a short time as well. So that's great context of where you've come from and what you're doing today. Can you share with us your vision moving forward for the public digital innovation space and what makes Taiwan unique in terms of its approach to digital innovation?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for example, during the pandemic, which we countered with no lockdown, and the infodemic, which we countered with no takedown, the response had not been anything that's like a, you know, shutdown, lockdown kind of way, but rather something that comes from the social sector. Taiwan is unique in having the same generation of people, that's my generation, having the first experience to the World Web in 96, and also the first presidential election in 96. So our democracy kind of grew with the internet, and that results in people who care about democracy deeply instead of democracy just as a ritual. People invented new ways to increase the bit rate of democracy, not just 3 bits every 4 years, every person is called voting, but rather a presidential hackathon, the GovZero community, G0V, the participatory mechanisms on deliberative democracy, including participatory budgeting and things like that. So during the pandemic, all our three major systems, the mask rationing system, the contact tracing QR code based checking system, and our vaccination reservation system are all co-created actually from the social sector. It's the civic tech people prototyping these services, forking the government as a call to action of GovZero, and then we just merging them back in into the mainstream government. So it's kind of procurement in reverse, right? They have the spec and we implement the spec.
Very cool. And you sort of touched on my next question, which was three approaches that you did take. But if you did have a magic wand, is there anything you could have done better during the pandemic with your digital strategy? Or I suppose based on some of the builds you've been able to do, you're really happy with how you've been able to managing the rollout across Taiwan?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. I think that the one thing that we did not get right was the kind of vaccination willingness. When I myself got vaccinated in April, I tried to convince my colleague and my family, and none of them want to get vaccinated. They're like, there's zero COVID cases for the past 10 months. We don't need to get vaccines for anything. And so I was kind of weird at the time. And of course, that's the result is that when we actually do need vaccines in June and July and so on, it created this huge spike of demand that we could have spread out in multiple months, and which is what brings me to Project Fairshot and the waiting room technologies. So I guess we could have done better in like February or March or something to try to promote better the vaccination and just to work on a more exciting vaccination reservation system actually gets the entire society talking. So if we partner with Cloudflare sooner, I guess it will help the vaccination rate.
Well, that's great to hear, and it's a nice segue to my next question as well. And obviously the spike was something that we collectively had to overcome. That is probably one challenge. But what other challenges have you faced working with Cloudflare, and how did you overcome those challenges? And what are the benefits you're also seeing after implementing such solutions?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'll be very candid, right? The first challenge is that when the Project Fairshot first got deployed in Taiwan in the 1922 vaccine reservation system, people saw on the error page that the traffic is going to Singapore. The data flow with trust concept is particularly true when it comes to medical and health information, of course. And I would like to express my gratitude to the Cloudflare team, which configured kind of a kind of made-to-order topology that handles both the spike in traffic and also making sure that it doesn't route through, say, the Hong Kong data center.
Great to hear. And again, thank you for your patience there. I know there was some delicate times, but it's great that we're able to rally and get you that capacity and after some of the sort of the data requests that you had. Mm-hmm. Taking it up a little bit, if we think more broadly around sort of Taiwan's digital strategy, and we're thinking more around, I suppose, cloud as a sort of a shift, within the Taiwan economy, what's the broad sort of adoption of cloud? I'm assuming it varies between relevant industries. Is it sort of the new normal, or is there still sort of old school enterprises that are still thinking hardware on-prem is still the way to go?
Mm-hmm. Well, Taiwan has a very vibrant social sector based on the free software and open source and liber. Actually, I just got an email from Richard Stallman this morning, and he used the term "自由," which is the Mandarin for liber, and free as in freedom. So he's very aware that we've got a very active communities here committed to those ideas. So Taiwan has been, I think, one of, if not the most active research center, for example, with the Ethereum Foundation and of the Web3, like decentralized web stuff. And a lot of Taiwanese startups kind of assumes this idea of bringing code to data, to personal data, data sovereignty, data dignity stuff, and start to make it their business model. So I think our kind of very liberal regulatory landscape when it comes to crypto, as well as a very vibrant social sector that commits on the software freedom and data dignity principles, made such startups possible at all, right? So, and I'm really happy to see that Cloudflare being kind of a re-decentralization, centralized ally is offering some help in creating IPFS gateways and so on as well. I personally know many startups that commits their work on IPFS.
Awesome. Yes, we definitely do like the decentralized edge approach. So that's great to hear. Mm-hmm. What about some other recent initiatives that the government's helping drive around technology? How are you, I suppose, coaxing or encouraging the private sector to be a little bit more innovative, and that sort of innovation spirit within Taiwan?
Yeah, and we're talking about, say, the famous night market, like bubble tea selling stunts, right? Who traditionally trust anything that's, you know, not just on-premise, but containing a machine, and then to use cloud technology, not just for POS, but also for customer relation management and things like that. So to that end, we have a T-Cloud website for Taiwan Cloud, and also we have a the T-Ambassador website. So these two end of us basically says, okay, if you're a bubble tea selling night market stunt, you can just use your personal phone number to register to try any of the cloud solutions, and the state will subsidize 80% of it up to, I think, more than $1,000 actually, which is a non-trivial amount for them to take a first try. And also, if the entire night market community want to digitally transform the way that they work, for example, with taxi fleets during the height of our real only first wave to deliver, transform to a deliver to home service, then we have people freshly graduated from undergrad and studied with the design thinking and computational thinking and so on to try to transform with the entire community. So it's kind of ambassadorship. It's just exactly like my role, reverse mentoring the Taiwanese cabinet in 2014, not really to take over. I'm too young to take over the cabinet positions, but really to just to make them feel differently when it comes to digital transformation, that actually it's easy to do. It reduces the risk and it's also safer.
Awesome. I've got two last questions. I want to leave some questions for you to ask the Cloudflare team. You've got at least north of 250 people in this session today. Firstly, how has the government dealt with remote working during the pandemic?
With the what?
How has the government, the Taiwan government, dealt with remote working during the pandemic?
Well, the thing is that we've never locked down. So I always, yeah, which is why I reordered the question to put it to last, because yeah, we prepared for remote work, and I'm a teleworking minister. As you can see, I'm not in a cabinet office. I only visit the cabinet office Monday and Thursday, but I never stopped visiting the cabinet office Monday and Thursday either during May and June. So I think Taiwan is really quite exceptional in this. We make a lot of equipment and online platform and so on for telework. But for our public sector and also most of our private sector in manufacturing, we did not really experience telework in the past couple of years.
Perfect. Okay, and then one last question for me, Audrey. Mm-hmm. So in your current role, as I said, you've seen the terms overall trends when it comes to cloud adoption in Taiwan. Mm-hmm. How are you seeing it relate to cybersecurity?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and in Taiwan, we've got this National Center for High-Speed Computation, or NCHC, and we're basically pushing out this idea that PET, privacy enhancing technology, could be one of our exports. So we work very hard on homomorphic encryption, differential privacy, federated learning, split learning, and various technologies. The idea is that if we want to upload everything to Cloudflare workers, for example, storing as durable objects, it will be all encrypted during the computation, and only the person actually receiving the message, the person who kind of own their own personal data and interpersonal data, if it's a community, can decrypt the results. So if Cloudflare has experience working on these, not just encrypted at rest, but also encrypted during computation, ways of computation, then we're really happy to talk. I think we're being natural allies. Most of our contact tracing system is based on this secure multi-party configuration, which made it one of the actually working contact tracing system that doesn't aggregate any data anywhere.
Let us take that challenge and come back to you very quickly. Last question for me, and as I said, I'd love you to ask us or give us some insights. Is there anything we can be doing better? You know, how can we improve? And I suppose, is there any asks of Cloudflare?
Uh-huh. Well, so as you probably know, we're evaluating to bring a lot of our backend code to the workers' platform. And at this moment, I guess, because it's all in legacy languages such as, okay, not really legacy, industrial languages such as Java or .NET. Currently, it's not in Rust or anything that's natively WebAssembly. So that toolchain, I guess, is preventing most of our backend to worker migration. And that's something we can work on together.
Awesome. Well, Audrey, thank you so much. It's not often you get to interview a digital minister of a very important country within this region. You know, it's not often that someone can go so deep as well and understand some of our products and how it's enabling your country in a really important time. So we really appreciate your insights, really appreciate the opportunity to talk. And we really appreciate the partnership so far. Hopefully we just got started and continue to build trust and look forward to doing great things moving forward. So thank you so much for your time today.
Thank you. Live long and prosper, everyone. Bye.
Thank you, Audrey.